Welcome to the Lockdown Lectures, where we're learning about the lives of some of Manchester's amazing researchers. Today we're joined by Perdita Barran, Professor of Mass Spectrometry and Director of the Michael Barber Centre for Collaborative Mass Spectrometry at the University of Manchester. Working with her team, Perdita diagnosed Parkinson's disease using its odour. Her breakthrough involved an analytical scientific instrument called a mass spectrometer and the skills of Joy, a retired nurse from Scotland who has an incredible sense of smell. Parkinson's disease is a devastating condition that will affect 1 in 15 people in the world. We'll now welcome Perdita to learn more about her life and research. Welcome.
So, hi, thank you.
How are you coping with the lockdown? Has there been any compulsive reading or viewing or anything in particular that's got you through?
So there's been some moments, which I think we've all had. I really miss being in the lab and being with my team. So the things that are outside of science that have got me through have been quizzes with a lot of old friends and family, and actually Zoom charades has been really good fun. It works very well and surprisingly well. So that's been fun. The other thing that's got me through has been initiating and working with many colleagues on a coalition of mass spectrometrists to use mass spectrometry to reduce the harm of the COVID-19 disease. So we started a coalition. We've now got 400 members, which represents about 200 labs from across the world. 18 countries are involved, and we're all working together to try to share methods and to take samples from patients to see what we can do and what we can understand about this disease. So that's been a really great thing and has got me through some of it.
And in terms of your research, what was the spark that inspired you to pursue that area of research? And did you face any challenges along the way?
So I think I've always been someone who has never wanted to give things up. And I was an undergraduate at Manchester. I did chemistry from 1990 to 1994, so a long time ago. And I actually chose chemistry because at the time, and I think it's still the case, it's the degree subject that allows people go from it into the widest range of professions. And I chose it because of that. I thought, well, it's not going to restrict any of my options. And so it's somewhat amusing that I'm now a chemistry professor back at Manchester. But I think I also have chosen mass spectrometry because it's an area of science which also really doesn't restrict your options. So in my lab, we look, as we'll talk about, at molecules that are diagnostic of Parkinson's disease, but we also look at really large proteins, including virus proteins. We also look at molecules that are synthetic, we look at polymers, and we work with a great number of different scientists to use mass spectrometry. So I think in the end, it's an area of science that allows me to be interested in lots of different things, as long as my core is understanding how to make the measurement.
And over on Twitter, Neil Condren would like to know, is it possible to say what Parkinson's disease smells like?
Right, yeah, so we get asked this a lot, and I have to answer as Joy would answer, because I have a very poor sense of smell. I had a bike injury 20 years ago, and I lost a lot of my sense of smell. But Joy has an exceptionally good sense of smell and is really able to define odour. She's able to be selective about it. And so she says that it smells, firstly, unlike anything else. So it's very distinctive and sort of musky. So almost like, like a muskrat, which we don't smell very often, but that kind of rather deep, slightly earthy odour. So that's what she says.
And Suzanne Ross has asked, do you think that COVID-19 can be detected through the sense of smell?
So that's a really interesting question, and we have been asked it. We have a collaboration with a group in Tanzania who have rats that smell tuberculosis, and we are working with them. Joy is working with them, and my colleague Drew Petrovedi is working with them to see if we can use some of the same methods we've used for Parkinson's disease for tuberculosis. Now, We had a meeting with them just yesterday, a meeting like this, a Zoom meeting, to ask that question. And we all decided, and I think it's true, that the actual virus will not smell, that the virus particles won't smell. The response of the individual to the infection may well have an odour. One of the things we are fairly certain about with the Parkinson's odour is that it's produced due to molecules called lipids, which are long-chain fatty acids, and they are being regular, their expression, the amount of them that's there changes when people are suffering from Parkinson's disease, and that was known. With COVID, with the SARS-CoV-2 illness, I think there will be an equivalent inflammatory response to that, and that may well have an odour, but we think there are probably other methods to see whether people have coronavirus or not.
Valerie Essien asks, what characteristics are needed to be a good researcher, regardless of subject area or industry?
Okay, it's a really nice question. I think there is no one perfect person. I think I can speak for me. I'm a very extroverted and pretty optimistic person, and I've got a lot of persistence. So I'm quite, I sort of want things to work, and I'll find a way for them to work. I think what's really important is that ability to be creative. Things, you know, you sort of think as an undergraduate that science is all about things working and getting the right yield or getting the right result, but you realize as you go through, and particularly in your final year when you do a longer project and things don't work so well, that actually science is really about trying things and finding out whether they do work or they don't work. And I think where some people struggle is when something doesn't work and they can't find a way around that. So you need to be the person that if you can't go from A to B, you work out how to get to B via C, right? If that makes sense. So I think that persistency is important. I don't think a scientist has to be extroverted. I am, but I have in my team people who definitely aren't and who are quiet, careful, and also persistent scientists. And so I think we need a range of people who can bring something to bear. But I think in the end, you've got to love what you do, and that's pretty important too.
Yeah, that's so important. And because we're all away from campus at the moment, what do you miss most about the University of Manchester?
Oh, I miss the crowds. I miss seeing all the students. I miss that kind of that sense of knowledge that you get on a university campus. I miss seeing colleagues. I miss being in my lab and seeing the great results that people in my team are getting. So all of that. But you know, a lot of it is happening. It's happening in bedrooms, or it's happening in kitchens. It's happening electronically. So it is still there. It's just, it seems like it's in suspended animation, but actually a lot is going on.
In hindsight, looking back, what advice would you have given to yourself at the start of your career?
I think, I feel incredibly lucky with respect to what I'm doing. I really am, you know, in the place I want to be, as in Manchester University, doing the science I want to do with people I really rate. So it's hard for me to say that I did something wrong, but I think saying no to things is probably what I advise younger starting lecturers to really pick carefully what they want to do, and not to just because, so here is how I would put it, just because you could do something, it doesn't mean you've got the time to do something. And I think a lot of academics suffer from having more ambition than the time they have to fulfill that ambition. And I'm definitely one of those people. So that is still advice I give to myself, or try to.
And finally, what advice would you have given to yourself at the start of the lockdown?
I started writing a diary, so that was something I did, and it's quite boring. It sort of says this today I did this, today I did that. I hope I'll look back on it and know something. And then I think the other thing that I've really learned, and I think a lot of us have learned, is that the barrier to talking to people is really low. So many of us have have called up old friends or video called old friends and family members that we don't often see because we're kind of all in it together. And I think that's been a very good thing about it, that we can, you know, have those conversations we put off for a while, and we can have them now. So.
Perdita, thank you very much for answering those questions, and thank you to everybody that did submit a question. I'll now hand over to you for your lockdown lecture.